Oh, we are live now on YouTube. I would request Jyoti Prakash to continue with the initial formalities of the session.
Thank you, Devasis. Good evening, everyone. This is Jyoti Prakash Datta, co-founder Team Lex Corners NT. I welcome you all on behalf of my team to this edition of Lex Corners NT Trend Show series. So before I introduce the eminent guest of this evening, I must tell you the purpose behind organizing this series. The basic reason behind this interview series is to facilitate and provide the legal fraternity with some invaluable anecdotes and escapades of several legal luminaries and dons. Experiences are invaluable and non-inheritable. So these precious anecdotes must be shared and preserved to serve as guiding lights for the generations to come. So we truly believe that stories of struggle, legal adventures, and unequal display of skills of advocacy must be conveyed to all the members of the fraternity. And above all, our endeavor is to create some positivity and motivation amidst this toxic environment that is prevailing due to the outbreak of the global pandemic COVID-19. So we are fortunately today joined by Sri N. Venkatramana. I welcome you, sir. Sir is a designated senior advocate, presently serving as Additional Solicitor General of India. He was designated in the year 2006 at a very young age of 39. He is a noted jurist in taxation and commercial laws. He has an exquisite practice of more than 32 years before the Honorable Supreme Court and almost all the high courts of the country. He is a cognizant in the areas of indirect taxation, direct taxation, international taxation, and constitutional law. And his unexampled expertise in constitutional and public law was also very known to everyone. And he received accolades from the Apex Court for the expertise in the same areas in the Sabarimala matter, wherein the constitution bench was convinced and pleased to send the matter for a review to 9 judges' constitutional bench. And recently in April, in a high-stake matter concerning a plea challenging ISRO's commercial antics, winding up proceeding against Devas Multimedia Private Limited before the Karnataka High Court, sir was successful in convincing the court that the registrar falls in the category of regulator under the Companies Act. And he was also successful in getting a favorable order for antics. And on 25th May 2021, just 5 days back, he got an order from the NCLT, Bengaluru bench, which ordered winding up of the Devas Multimedia. So, sir, it is our good fortune to have you on board for this interview session. I welcome you again on behalf of my team. Thank you, sir, joining us. Thank you for joining us. And today, sir, as we know, you are an eminent advocate. That is an undeniable fact. But today we are very fortunate to have you as a guru. So today we want you as a teacher and a guru who will enlighten us with his enormous knowledge and all the experiences that you have. So with your permission, sir, I would like to start the first phase of the interview and then Devasis will join in the second phase.
Before you start the first
question. Sure, sir. Sure, sir.
Sharada Sharadambuja Vadana Vadanambujai Sarvata Sarvata Asmatam Sannitim Sannitim Kriya. My dearest children and co-practitioners, I thought I should say this before I take the first question. Orissa High Court is very close and dear to my heart. And practitioners in Orissa High Court know me so well, as much as people who know me in Chennai. I'll tell you the reason. When I got designated in February 2006, the first high court I visited outside Chennai after designation is Orissa High Court. And my first appearance in Orissa High Court is 10th March 2006. And from there on, a very, very long association of 14 years till I became an ASG last year. And I'm still looking forward to go there. I've enjoyed my visits to Bhubaneswar and enjoyed the companionship with all the fellow advocates and senior counsels and the learned judges. Orissa is, Bhubaneswar is very close to my heart. And I'm so happy that I'm getting an opportunity to talk to people from whom I had benefited a lot. So I'm so happy to be part of your session. Namaste. Yes, Jyoti, you can now start.
Thank you, sir. It is outstanding to see your love for our city, sir. It is really, we are fortunate to have you. So, sir, first beginning with a fundamental question. First of all, I want to know what was your childhood background and how you came to find law as your career?
In fact, I do not know. I can say it has been always my passion to become a lawyer. From a very young age, my teachers found me that I had the ability to speak in public. So when I was in the second class at the age of 7, I started to do public speeches. So in those days, you do not have this type of internet and all, very, very limited. So people who have been listening to me over years as a student started to encourage me that I should take to law. This is one part. But what motivated me the most was Nani Palkiwala ji came to Madurai. I was then in Madurai. That was the only time he visited Madurai. And he gave a speech for 2 hours. And I had the good fortune of watching him for 2 full hours. And the seed of inspiration was sown through that talk that I should become an advocate. And this happened in the year 1980, when I was 79 or 80, when I was doing the 10th standard. And from there on, I had only one ambition to become an advocate. Otherwise, I don't come in the family of advocates or somebody practicing earlier in our family, not that. This is the background, and Naniji was my sole inspiration to take to law profession. Yeah. Am I audible?
Indeed, sir. You are audible. Yes, sir. So it is very nice to know that the legendary Nani Palkiwala inspired you to take up law. And he was also a legend, and he has also inspired a legend who is present before us today. And sir, the second thing that I want to know from you is that when did you join the law school? And what was your initial days of the law school like? And whether you were more inclined towards co-curricular activities or you were more focused towards the academic studies?
See, I did law between 1983 and 89. 88, 5 years. First batch of 5-year integrated law in the country. Now, in those days, we did not have these many opportunities for moot courts. We had only one moot court at Pondicherry and model courts within the campus. So from the second year, we were more focused in doing moots rather than focusing on academics. But somehow I had a personal passion for constitutional law. And I came into contact with a person who was practicing income tax in Madurai. So taxation was, because Naniji did these two. He was a constitutional expert and he was a taxation counsel. So that impression was always in the back of my mind that these two laws I should pursue as a career. And we were focused more on preparation of moots, arranging moots within the college, and doing enormous public speaking. We were trying to only shape up our public speaking skills those 5 years, I should say, besides academics. This was how I could prioritize it. I remember it only that way.
Indeed, sir. Sir, after that, when you passed the law degree, after that, to whom you joined as a junior for starting your litigation career?
See, I will slightly broaden this question. According to me, I think children should know more about this. This is one area which is very, very important to me in my life. And therefore, this is a life learning. And therefore, I want to spend a few minutes on this question, if you permit me, Jyoti.
Sure.
Dear children, what is very, very important, whether it is 30 years back or 30 years later, for you to succeed in the profession, you should be blessed. God should bless you with a good mentor. It is so invaluable. Your senior decides the fate line of your career. Take it from me. That relationship today is very, very in our days, it was very emotional. It was very, very personal. And it was almost one-on-one. But today, you're all with firms. The permutations, life has changed in 30 years. But the essence still remains the same. If you all believe, because you are well-versed in computers, you can access things in life and you can assimilate. Your assimilation abilities are far superior, far, far superior than what we all had 30 years back. You are endowed with more resources. I have to say that every child in the law school is brilliant in any part of the country. And you all think well, you want to progress well, you have good vision, good ideas. These are all very good. But the nature works only this way. You must be guided by a good senior. So unless you find a good mentor, you can't shape as a great lawyer. That way, I was one of the few who had been blessed enormous. Whatever I am today in my life, I owe it to my spiritual guru, my mentor, my spiritual mentor, and my professional mentor. Without these two people, I would not be before you talking as currently the ASG of this country. It's not possible. It's a thing I want to admit openly and very happy. So mentor matters the most. And should I, Jyoti, explain what my mentor did to me, or you are going to have a question on that?
No, sir. It will be great if you explain that.
I won't explain it because children benefits.
Yes,
see,
sir, yes.
There are three things you should learn as a student in the institution and when you come out and work with a mentor. Institutional mentors are also people to be respected. Unless you respect the institution to which you belong and respect the teachers who help you out, don't be disrespectful in life. It's so elementary. And you should be grateful to the university till your last for having given the university, giving you the opportunity. These two things are very essential as a student. Once you come to a mentor, this is what I learned personally from my mentor. The first thing on the day I joined him, the first lesson he taught me was, every time when a client comes and sits before you, I was not married at that time, I was only 23 years old. But he told me, you should park this feeling in your mind. How your wife should be treated and attended by a doctor when she's sick and you take her to the hospital. You would expect a doctor to attend to her well. That is the kind of attitude you must have in your mind whenever you take a case. It's the first lesson he taught me. Now the second, very important is, he told me, Venkatraman, it is not you can't pick and choose as small cases or big cases, or cases which give money and cases which don't give money, and be indifferent to small cases and cases which do not give you money. This is a wrong path for you to grow in the profession. Every case that comes your way is a case. And whatever time it requires for you to invest in that case, you must invest in that case, and that alone will make you go. This was the second lesson he taught me. The third is, as a lawyer, whether you are a junior and how you are growing, you must be fully prepared for that case. Like, it's easy. After all, first a senior will say, what will your senior do? He'll say, go for this admission which is already admitted. He'll send you for only small matters. You can't get straight away a constitutional matter. Not many get it. So he will send you for very small matters, send you for an adjournment. Even if you have to go for an adjournment with a brief, read that brief thoroughly. Be prepared. For any reason, one young judge feels, oh, here's a youngster, upcoming youngster, at least to tease you. Or he wants to motivate you. He says, I will give you adjournment only when you narrate what the case is. You should not be stuck. So, whichever brief comes to you, read it inside out. You must be fully prepared. And whatever you want to argue, see, you may get an opportunity to argue fully, argue 10%. You may choose to argue only a little, but preparation has to be complete. You will always say, the arrow should be on your back, not somewhere else to say, no, my arrows are somewhere, let me go and fetch it. It's like a war, you are in a battlefield. Your arrow should always, you may use it, you may not use it, but you should be fully prepared. The fourth point he taught me was ethics. You have to be fair, you have to be transparent, and you must preserve unquestionable integrity with the bar, with the bench. These three things, see, all long surviving, successful, I'm not saying successful in terms of material wealth or popularity, respected counsels across the country in any bar, you are respected by everybody, generations after generations, only when you have these three qualities. You may be successful, otherwise you may be very popular also, but you will not be remembered or respected unless you have these three qualities. And five, when it comes to money, two things you should remember very well, very clearly. Don't have money as a destination when you do a case. Case and its outcome should be the destination. He always cited this example. Climbing a tree is very difficult. But once you know to climb the tree, picking cherries are very, very easy. Monies are like picking cherries. Initial years, you will struggle. The profession is like that. And today, if you work for firms, they will pay you well, by God's grace. So you don't struggle at all. But incentive should be work and effort and not money. And the second principle in money is never chase money. Never chase anything, especially money. Because if you start chasing money as your destination, you will tend to compromise your values. And once you start compromising, then there is no end to it. You will say, chalta hai na, no problem. The moment you start that window, open the window, then you can go anywhere from 0 to 100. So this is as far as money is concerned. Then as far as doing the job, how focused you should be. He always says, he has said that to me, and he has cited his own examples. You will find every human being, every young lawyer, we'll come across somebody who will inspire. I'm not talking about biographies. I'll come to that a little later. You will find in your real life someone inspiring you. Don't leave that inspiration. To me, personally, when I was a student and I got married and I was there for 15 years in a particular place, till 40 years, then I moved out. So in these 15, 17 years of my life, two inspiring characters in my life were my barber and the person who used to iron my clothes. The kind of sincerity with it's a monotonous job. Day in and day out, there is no promotion, there is no variation, there is no creation, there is no innovation, there is no recognition. But the way these two people did their jobs, my God, it continues to inspire me. Every day I think of them. So how focused one has to stay in ironing the clothes? It's a job. If somebody thinks it's such a monotonous, dirty job, the man's frame of mind from morning till evening, day in and day out, year after year, has remained the same. Both to that barber and to the man who did my laundry. So like that, God will show you somebody to be inspired with. Don't leave that person. God will provide you opportunity. Everybody will be provided an opportunity. Catch hold of that person. Find that person as an ideal in your life. And please do concentrate, have the desire to work, have the passion to perform well. And as a lawyer from day one, don't expect results because that is not in your hands. And don't get worked up with results. Good cases are lost and bad cases are won. It is so common in the legal profession. So the final point I thought, when he was about to die, 6 months before that when I met him, this was a moving message he gave me, which I shall cherish till I am cremated. He told me, Venkatraman, he has put, say, 50 plus years of service. Initial years, I assumed myself as a painter. I loved innovating, I loved creating, I loved doing things. But over a period of time, I matured from a painter to a sculptor. For a minute, I was just looking at his eyes. And he said, you must know the difference. A painter takes an empty paper and creates a work, which is great. Whereas a sculptor takes an irregular shape, irregular rock shape, starts removing things which needs to be removed, and finally creates the idol which he wants to make in life. So how does the idol emerge? Remove the parts which needs to be taken out, then the idol emerges. So you must sculpt every matter you do in your life. This is my message to you. After that, he died. So these are the impressions I continue to carry in my life, only because I was blessed with such a great senior. His name is Mr. C. Natarajan. The kind of accolades he got, the kind of recognitions. House of Lords, when they visited Madras, the Chief Justice called him to argue a case before the House of Lords. In fact, you always used to say, you guys in your life may have to go there and do, but hey, House of Lords came to our court and I had the opportunity to argue. This is the kind of reputation. And he was a great human being by heart. He taught me, you have to be generous always with money. And said this, I want to part this idea with my children, with all the children. See, when you want to do something good, when you earn, everybody has a passion to do something good. Plan before you receive the money, how much you should allocate for what you want to do. Plan it first. Because the tendency of a human being is once money comes into the account, then you will start thinking, why not we use it ourselves? So take that. If you're going to collect 1 lakh rupees at some point of time as a great fee and you want to park 25,000 for your own priority, imagine that you're going to receive only 75,000 rupees. First, then you will have the tendency to do more and more things which you are passionate about. I'm so sorry I've taken a longer time, but I felt these are important aspects which children should know. And I took this time. If I overstep, I'm so sorry, but this is very important according to me.
Not at all, sir. These are really very much valuable and we preserve all these advices. And it is our fortune that we got to know about these advices from you that was taught by your great teacher. So we couldn't have learned it without this particular interview session and without your explanation. So we are very much fortunate, sir. Thank you for explaining all those things, especially the difference between painter and sculpture. That is very much important. And after all, you have very rightly pointed out that Guru plays a very vital role in shaping our everything. Yes, sir.
I want thank all you, sir. The children to be blessed with a good mentor. My best prayers to all of you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Sir, after that, we will go to another aspect. In a life of a lawyer, it is very much important to read important judgments to keep the track of landmark judgments. So, sir, how do you take it? How do you keep track of the judgments?
In fact, it's a very good question. I don't know who has prompted. It's a nice question. See, this is exactly what my senior taught, and I'm practicing for 32 years. Initially, till you come to the grips of law, till you reach a position where you can interpret the law yourself, it will take some time. You must understand the law as pronounced by the judgments. So when you see in law, you must presume this. Every proposition would have been discussed at least once in some way or the other. There's nothing called an untested terrain. You only expand into new horizons from an old horizon. This is the conception you should have when you read a judgment. So try to understand an interpretation of the law as how judgments reflected it on it. These are initial years. It will take initials, can even be 10, 15 years. But my senior taught me, once you reach a level of maturity where you can read the law the way you want and the way it has to be and interpret it without tweaking it, without twisting it, without trying to take undue advantage of it. If you're able to interpret the law, whichever law comes your way, if you gain that ability, then when you read a judgment, you must have the maturity to analyze whether the judgment has found or interpreted the law correctly. That's the stage. Initial stage, you have to follow because you are a learner. You can't go and suddenly, when you are 3-year-old, go and tell a judge, no, this judgment is wrong. Judges are not going to take it so easily and lightly. And even if you want to express your view at that stage, if you're competent, you have to be extremely polite. Because unless we respect judgments as lawyers, then who will respect judgments? Whether it is right or wrong, judgments ought to be respected. Because it comes from a judge. And judges should be respected. These are all systemic needs for you to preserve an institution as a noble institution. So you can't be speaking ill of judges. You can't be speaking ill of judgment left, right, and center in the name of freedom of speech. It's all not right. I mean, I may belong to a classical school, but this is the school I want. I mean, whatever you become, you ask a question, I'm reflecting. So when you read, when you reach a level of maturity, read the law and find the judgment and see whether it's right or wrong. And then put forth your view that this judgment ought to have interpreted this provision this way. And it has failed to do so this way. This is how you should understand and learn judgments. And without understanding and reading judgments, you can't become a successful lawyer.
Very enlightening, sir. Very rightly you have pointed out that without understanding judgment, we can't be successful lawyers. And also you have pointed out that we have to respect judges. That is a point that is worth highlighting, because we may go against the judgment, we may not support a particular judgment, but we have to respect the judges, because it comes, they are the institutions in themselves. So that is a very valuable advice.
You have to, sir, polite. Yes. You have to be very polite and never develop a conflict either with the judges or with your opponent. However good or bad the opponent counsel may be, extend your tolerance to the maximum extent possible. You will be liked by the court. You start giving back to back on your poga on the opponent counsel, judges are not going to be appreciative, because sitting as a judge, he will know who is talking rubbish and who is talking sense. So stay always on the path of sensible presentation, irrespective of how your opponent is. The court will know. Leave it to the court. You don't judge every time. A co-counsel. That's one more request I make to children.
Indeed, sir. You have termed yourself as classical school, but you don't belong from classical school. You might belong from classical school, but it is a thing that everyone should follow. It is a very valuable advice, sir. And we are very much grateful that you explained that particular point here in this interview session. And sir, as we know how you joined the bar and how you started your career and how your guru saved your career, and you also explained about judgment reading. So now we should come to your journey as a litigator, litigating lawyer. So as we know, you have handled so many cases. They are landmark ones. And we are very much interested to know about the recent Sabarimala judgment. That is a very important one, and it was highlighted by media. So can you please explain about that, sir?
Matter is subjudice, so I should not be, and now I'm holding a different position also, I should be careful in talking about it, but what I can tell you in a conceptual way. See, this shows the strength of our judiciary. The hallmark of Indian judicial system is, though under the constitution, the final interpreter of the law is the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court judgments are binding in every other court in India. Supreme Court judgment doesn't bind the Supreme Court itself. It has got the right and liberty to review. So it follows as binding. It's not follows it for consistency and uniformity, and if it finds the law to be the same. But it has got the right to differ. That's the beauty of our judicial system. So when five learned judges had delivered a judgment in Sabarimala in a particular way, we had two options. All of us filed it only as a review. But even in my application, which I settled and in which I appeared, I sought for a reference to a larger bench, much against the wish of great doyens of the bar. They all said, what you're doing is wrong. And this is not the classical approach. They were more classical than me. And they dissuaded me and said that you should argue only for review and not for reference. I somehow felt we were about 10, 12 people who were arguing. And in terms of seniority, I was 7th or 8th in the row in the sequence. When 7, 8 people have already exhausted that you should review, and the court was somehow taking a call how to go about it or putting questions, why should we do that? They all had very, I mean, they all were heard between 7 to 10 minutes. Somehow it's all ultimately divine power, and it happened that way. It's like a daily match, daily 2020 in a court. What happens that day is determined by several factors. I had the good opportunity of arguing for 27 minutes. And I opened up in the second minute saying that it has to be referred to a larger bench for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 reasons. 6 reasons, 7 reasons we gave. The Honorable Chief Justice was kind enough to first note it. And co-judges started to probe the matter on those lines. So it finally got referred to 9 judges, but the credit should go to everybody. I don't want to be saying I argued for reference, I was the one who got it. It's not. It's a complete team effort. Great people, elderly people, and people with enormous abilities also argued those matters. So finally, all the inputs put together made the court to refer the matter to 9 judges. So if you are convinced about a particular path, go for it. Your intuition will say, it will drive you towards that. Then listen to your inner voice and go for it. I did it in that matter. This is the broad way I can put Sabarimala instead of going into the nitty-gritty situation. at this point.
Absolutely, sir. You have delivered a great message that whenever conscience is with us, then we can go in that way and we will definitely get success. And you have also pointed out a very important thing here, that you have done a very spectacular job, but still you divide the credit between all the seniors. That is a very, it is your humility, sir, and that we adore indeed, sir.
This is very, very essential. Whether it's a client, whether it's your juniors, whether it's a court, whether it's an opponent, you are not alone as a performer to succeed. You are in the midst of ever so many combinations. And all the combinations should favor you in a particular case on a particular day. Only then you can succeed. So never take personal credit for your success or personal failure for what when you have failed. It is all a group of an association of several ideas, several people, several situations, and several other factors. So this is how you should be always. Only then you will remain level-headed in the profession. Otherwise, your ego will start bloating at some point of time, and then you will start to falter. If you have to remain sensible, this is a very important point. This is my personal view.
Indeed, sir. That's the reality, and you are very well pointed out this particular advice, and we are very much sure that it will help our viewers who will be viewing this video in the future and who are viewing this now. So, sir, it was a great conversation with you, and with this question, I would request Devasish to join our conversation, and he will take forward the interview session. Devasish, please. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So, thanks. Thank you, Prakash. Nice talking to you, and nice talking to the children through you. Thank you. Good questions. Very good questions raised.
Thank you, sir. Devasish, please take forward the conversation.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jyoti Prakash, for asking a couple of relevant questions. And I must surely say that sir has given enlightening answers, which will inspire countless law students who are viewing this right now and who will view this in future, as Jyoti Prakash just said. So continuing with the second phase of this particular interview, and as we have already discussed about your childhood, your inspiration, and the important case, that is Sabarimala case that you have appeared in, and then the importance of reading judgments, I would like to ask you another important aspect for a lawyer's life, that is drafting. So what are the important basic points that we should remember while drafting a particular petition, plaint, or anything for that matter? So if you can focus or set light on that.
It's a very good question. I'm very happy you raised it. And especially for young juniors, upcoming juniors, and the people who are going to join the profession, this is the question. See, the urge to argue, we have passion. The moment you wear the black coat, you would like to go and stand. You may have the ability to go and stand and argue. And if you get the opportunity, you'll do it also. I got the opportunity on the 10th day of my joining the profession. So each one gets it at some point of time. But what my senior did was, he told me, you must remain in the office for 3 years. And whenever required, I'll take you to the court. If you start coming to the court every day, you will only loiter in the verandas, keep gossiping with people, because court is a beautiful gossip center. You'll have wonderful, juicy information exchange. Time will pass, fly. Go to the canteen, start picking new friends, and you will lose focus. So whenever it is important, I will allow you to argue or send me to small cases. But otherwise, you should remain in office. Read, research, and draft. So children should focus on drafting at least for the first few years. It's a very good question. Why? Because, see, you cannot draft. By default, if you start drafting, you will get these qualities. First is clarity of thought. You can easily speak for 2 minutes in a court and get away, because those words will be forgotten. but what you write will remain. So keep drafting petitions, starting from an adjournment, doesn't matter. You will get slowly clarity of thought. And without clarity of thought, you can't be a good lawyer. One. And two, ideas will rush into your mind from different places. You will think A, B, C, D, 4. You may commit the mistakes of putting E first and D second and A third. All that will happen initially. Don't bother. Because you will think many people don't read drafts. Quote will read, quote may not read. It's immaterial. It's an experience for you, which you will realize at a later point of time how good drafting has helped you to reach bigger heights. Don't worry about whether people will read it or not. It is a free training and opportunity for you to become a good lawyer. Again, I repeat, it's a good question. So, second point, the second takeaway out of drafting is the ideas which rush, you will start slowly assimilating and putting it in a good shape as you progress. Three, good drafting will lead you to extraordinary conviction. You will get very good conviction about laws. The case which you pursue, you will start getting the grip, the courage. And when court starts asking you a question, you will get answers automatically. You may not be arguing the case. Your senior may be arguing it. Doesn't matter. But you will get, oh my God, this is what I thought when I drafted it. Oh, this is what the judge is asking. Exactly. This is the answer I have. Please start traveling with the court in your mind. Let your senior argue. This is exactly what my senior has taught me. Whatever I speak, I only speak what my senior has taught me. I'm telling you. Nothing is new. Nothing is on my own. So he may be arguing a question, but you have drafted it. So in your mind, you start addressing the court the way you have drafted. In your mind, you can do it even before a mirror. You can do it in your house when you have a time. This question, you take that question and come home and spend some time, half an hour. I've done it. Remember, my dear children, when you start arguing the case, these good drafting, these good rehearsals in mind will make you to speak very, very eloquently in a court. This may happen at a later point of time, but good drafting, good clarity, good eloquence, and a mental rehearsal of the questions that arises out of your grounds, rehearse it, will make you a very good lawyer at a later point of time. So concentrate on drafting. Don't think draft. Don't start cutting and pasting here and there. Same matter. Start that. No, it may be a same matter. Remember the painting, remember the sculpting. It may be the same painting, but you can't take a photocopy. You have to paint it again as an artist. You have to sculpt the title again. Do it again and again, even if it is a repetitive work. But do it originally every time. It will help you because initially you have time. After that, you will not have a time once you become busy. Use the time properly. Yeah.
Indeed, sir. You have very well pointed out the intricacies and nuances of drafting and gave us quite a great number of pointers that as a young legal professional we should always remember and adhere to. So thank you so much, sir, for this particular question. Now, while we were starting this particular interview, you have said about biographies and autobiographies of doyens of the bar and legal luminaries. So I would like to know from you that what is the importance of reading autobiographies of legal doyens or biographies of legal luminaries, and if you can shed some light on this particular aspect.
In fact, a wonderful question. I mean, you've all, I think, intensely prepared well. Very happy, very appropriate questions are put. See, as children, we first become we have to be inspired because we have not lived that life to give or share our experiences as, or have the experience, our experience as the basis for life. Because those things have not come at all. You can't imagine a seed to imagine that it will taste the fruit. It takes a long time before the plant grows into a tree, starts showing, putting leaves, then growing, finally the fruit emerging. So it's a process. Therefore, for you to stay inspired in whatever profession you are, you must read the biographies of the doyens of that profession. For example, in those days, I was first 2-3 years, I was more actively reading Perimism. Because that was the reach we had in a rural place. Because it trained your mind. He was one of the classical criminal lawyer approach in all his books in those days. Today you have several such opera apps and several such serials and all. That graduated me to read at least two people have influenced, the biographies of two people have influenced my life. One is reading the works of Naniji, and finally the biographies of Naniji, which came at a later point of time. Whatever Naniji wrote, whenever it came in a print media in those days, that was the only access, I used to buy it and then read it. His books, We the People, We the Nation, these are all for times to come, they will impact you as a lawyer. Similarly, Justice Chagla, M.C. Chagla's Roses in December. Amazing. Oh, it will impact any youth. The way he has conveyed his convictions, it's just amazing. So, read whomsoever you feel influenced. In fact, I read it at a later than, in fact, Soli Surabji, and Nariman, everybody has contributed so much. There are so many people's biographies which you can read, or their writings for that matter. And my senior was my idol throughout my life till he passed away 2 years back. And after that, if somebody who continues to inspire me, my senior continues to inspire me in my heart, but living legends, the present Attorney General of India, Shri K.K. Venugopal, who is 89 years old. My God. The ethics, the professional commitment that he has at this age, he should be worshipped, I think. When he gives a commitment for a VC call at 1:30, at 1:28, he will log and wait for you. Can you imagine? At 89. And any point you go and give it to him, he will try to add at least two more new dimensions. I'm a student to him because it is 35 years difference. I say this. So there is similarly, after my senior has passed away, there's one person who continues to motivate me is for one senior advocate in Karnataka, Mr. Holla, former Advocate General of the Karnataka High Court. He's at 12 o'clock, he will give appointments in the night for a client when he's 70 years old. 12 o'clock he will meet. We were traveling from Delhi to Bangalore and we landed at 9 o'clock. And I said, okay, sir, go and take rest. What are you saying? I'm traveling now to my office. I have an appointment at 10:30. At 70 years. So please see such live examples around you who will motivate you and read biographies. Whomsoever attracts you. Preferably these two. Naniji, and I have been influenced. There are other books also, equally good people. And improve, if you expand it a little further, read the biographies of great leaders, whether it is in corporate or in politics or as world leaders, whenever you find time, because every great achiever has some message to convey. Otherwise, he would not have become great. And he would not have been remembered beyond periods of time. So, in our country, there are several historical figures. I don't say political leaders within 100 years. For example, Mahatma Gandhi, when you read, Mahatma is a soul who will cut across centuries. You can't, one more Mahatma will be born only after 500 years. So you get into such history, and whenever you find time, read. Do some reading at least for 30 minutes. Naniji has said, read 1 hour literature and 1 hour things outside your profession. He said 2 hours. With modern time, at least do it half an hour each. Read something which will inspire you every day. That will keep you growing, independent of whatever motivates you in life. Sorry, I've taken some time, but this is important.
Indeed not, sir. We are really pleased to know the legends whom you have referred while answering this particular question, and the biographies or the autobiographies written by them, and the importance of drawing inspiration from those legal doyens, or as you said at the later part, the doyens in any profession, be it politics, be it business, be it corporate, be it legal, anything. So you have very well pointed out this particular aspect of reading for at least 30 minutes beyond your profession. So it was quite interesting and enlightening to know from you. Now, I would like to ask you a question which generally we tend to not to ask our speakers. That is related to moral ethics. If you get a case which is against your morality or personal morality, then what do you generally do? And what would be your take on that?
I will happily answer this. Why should you avoid? You should ask this question. See, this conviction has to come as a blessing in your life based on whom your mentor or senior is. Morality and ethics for a junior lawyer is something which he or she inherits. By getting inspired or influenced by the senior to whom you work or the people whom you associate in life. These are two opportunities God has to give you. My senior's ethical commitments were unsurpassable. His integrity was impeccable. When a dirty case comes to him, this is what he will sound the client. I will use all these dirty facts and tell the court transparently, these are the dirty facts. But this is how the law is, and therefore, can you interpret the law to his advantage? I will not suppress it. So, from day one, I can assure you, I have not defended a smuggler. I have not defended people who are anti-nationals. Never I have done this in my life, because my senior has not done it, and I will not do it for the rest of my life. Okay, whether as a profession, it's like this. This is the call you have to take. You run a hospital, somebody who has been a drunkard throughout his life, virtually his liver gets dissolved, and the family brings such a patient to your hospital. Can you say you get to docs, you go to docs because you are drunk, I can't help you? Whether medical profession says you have to admit that patient and treat. So a doctor has to take a call. Like that, in case somebody comes to you with such a position, you will have to take a call. But there again, don't suppress, don't hide. Don't burn documents. Don't misrepresent. If you misrepresent in one case, then that will become a habit in you. Take it from me. It is so inducing. So either decline the brief, and better you decline. My senior has always said, this is my discomfort. Therefore, I can do it only with this discomfort. If there is somebody who can surpass this discomfort and help you, I would request you to go to that somebody, because they will be in a better position to help you. Have the courage to decline that brief if your moral ethics does not permit you to do it. These are my two answers to young children. be ethical. It's very, very important. Only then it gives you happiness in your family. You can spread happiness in the society. You can stand up with courage and conviction as you grow in life to do or deliver a talk and say, this is what I feel life is. You can't do that if you are not ethical.
Absolutely, sir. Integrity, ethics, moral ethics, and morality in legal profession is very much important. And we should always inculcate all these things, all these behaviors in ourselves, which will help us in long run, as you rightly pointed out. Now, there is one question coming from our viewers, and I would like to ask you that. He is asking that, how do you handle disagreement with your seniors on a particular legal proposition or legal matter?
See, why senior? As a lawyer, you must know this, dissect in life very clearly. It's a good question, whoever has raised it. See, a case is a transaction. Please deal a case as a case. Don't take a case and convert it into a relationship issue. Relationship is independent of a case. Because every day in an adversarial litigation, one day you will be fighting somebody as an opponent lawyer. Next day he may be joining with you in some other case and you will be arguing the case together for defending two different defendants on behalf of somebody. This is so natural in our profession. So never develop relationship issues because of a case. Deal a case as a case. Deal a relationship as a relationship. This is one. Once you know that there is a difference between the two, if you have a disagreement, you should express your disagreement. And if your senior is not prepared, is not a person who will listen to your disagreement, then do your best and involve somebody who is ready to toe the line, because case should not be lost. Okay? So involve somebody and ask them to start doing that matter, because interest of the case should not go. But in a modern life, at least we may have some handicap in our early lives, but you may not have that handicaps. If your leader or your boss is open to views, express it. Otherwise, convey your dissent in such a polite way that you disagree because of the following views. If both are not possible, curse yourself and travel in that case as an extra baggage. Nothing else you can do.
Indeed, sir, you have very well given three pointers in the way to handle disagreement with your senior or anybody for that matter. Now, I would like to ask another question relating to young budding lawyers. What would be your roadmap to success that would help young legal professionals and law students, those who are viewing this particular video and who will view this in later form or later part?
Very good. I think it's a very apt question. I have some time. Is there any time restriction?
Indeed not, sir. We can go beyond. No, sir.
This is a very good question. I'll take little time, not much. See, I'll use this as a canvas. A lawyer has a dual role to play. This is my personal view. One, to remain as a lawyer and remain as a good professional. But beyond that, to remain as a good human being and serve the interest of the society and the nation to the extent possible. See, this is what Naniji has repeatedly said. It is the responsibility of every citizen, I don't deny it, more by lawyers. Because you connect, see, law and society, like science has some relevance to modern life, to everyday's life. Law and society has enormous influence to life. You, when you hold the law and you're going to be with part of the society, you have a role to play. This is something, don't be selfish. Naniji says, selfishness will not allow you to sacrifice in life. Selfishness and sacrifice don't go together. And in life, selfish success takes you only to a particular level. Whereas sacrifices lead you to stronger and longer sustainable success. This is one difference Naniji has taught. The second difference is, as a lawyer and as a citizen, you have a duty to the nation. You should always work for gross national happiness instead of gross national product. So you have a role to play to, in an emerging society, to make it very happy, for which two qualities are inevitable: discipline, your moral ethics, coupled with the right way to use your fundamental right of speech and thought. These are three important takeaways for young children. If you are not disciplined, you can't expect the society to be disciplined. And if your society is not disciplined, the nation will not be disciplined. And a nation which is clothed with indiscipline, democracy will be a chaos and a total failure. This is exactly what Naniji says. So, self-discipline, promote social harmony and discipline, promotes national discipline. Democracy works well only in a disciplined society and a self-disciplined society. This is number one. Two, what is moral ethics? He says, don't start pointing fingers, he is immoral, he is unethical, and he is successful. That's none of your business. If everybody starts showing that as an example and start living, an immoral society and an immoral nation will again be a disaster to democracy. So, don't measure somebody's moral ethics as a yardstick for your life. You don't compromise your ethics and principles and start contributing your best. If each one of you can do that little as youth, see, we have rightly or wrongly lived 55 years. And we don't know what God has in store for us. But you have to still run extra 30 more years than us, because you are yet to cross from 20-25 to 30-50-55. That 30-35 years matters, very critical for you. So you have a longer, larger responsibility. Don't pollute the society with unethical practices from your end. If each one of you can think of that, then it's a great service you have done to society. The third is remaining selfish or the mind to sacrifice. Building a society, building a nation in a democratic way comes only through sacrifice, not through plundering. Before you take something out of this nation, think what you have done to the nation. This is how democracy gets sustained, generation after generation, in which Naniji 35 years back predicted. See, all of us, the freedom of thought and expression, which was restricted in our era, is now given open, free for all of you. But anything given free, and anything given in an unrestricted way, and anything given with your own conviction of self-restrictions and self-impositions, is again going to be a disaster to democracy. Mindless freedom of thought and expression. What do you mean by mindless? I have the freedom to express whatever I can in the public domain is different from that what you express should be right in your judgment. This significant difference, I pray to each of you as a child, you should enjoy the freedom of expression and thought because you're all intelligent and resourceful. And many of you are self-made. But it is an inflammable stuff. Use it very, very preciously because courts are not going to put the restrictions anymore. Society are not going to put. See, we are reaching in an era where judgments say parents have no control over the children. Society cannot monitor the children. Institutions cannot interfere with children's rights and liberties. So you are left to fend yourself. It is good, then you think it's good. It is good, but we need still family, we need still society, we still need nation. If you think so, then allow you to orient yourself with elements of sacrifice, elements of alignments in which way you should grow so that the society and the nation improves, and contribute your thoughts, your expressions, which will add value to the nation. And the last, in the name of freedom of speech and thought, I request again to each one of you, instead of conflict, go for assimilation. Don't generate thoughts which are conflicting. Instead, go for thoughts where you can assimilate together as a nation. In fact, Naniji says, each one of us have our own ideas, but the nation's aim and the nation's ideals remain the same. So, align your ideas, whatever it may be, with the nation's aim and the nation's goals, so that all of you try to live in harmony. See, harmony will give you better life, quality of life than conflict. Love, unlimited love and affection can give you a better quality of life than hatred. And sacrifice for the sake of a nation building, rather than being selfish to yourself, can give you better quality of life and promote better democratic values. So use your freedom of thought and expression using all this. Please add value. It's your nation. You are responsible for your nation. The nation you make, because that is the power of democracy. And as a lawyer, you should be clearly aligned with the Constitution, its values, and the democratic principles. Use it in a way which harmonizes and ultimately promote a nation in your era, free from hatred and harmony, more of love, more of universal thinking. Our culture will remain. See, our culture has permeated centuries, yugas. And let's all grow under that value system together as Indian, as an Indian thought, influencing the nation, because everywhere, everybody is now assimilating India's thought process, whereas we are dumping it. Don't do that. Be together. Oneness of Indian thought, in spite of plurality of views, is something you should have it as your agenda in life and work. Be friendly, be lovable, be harmonious. You will enjoy so much inner peace in your life, and you can contribute greater peace to the universe. Sorry, I took a lot of time, but children should know it.
Indeed not, sir. This particular answer, in this particular answer, you have given almost, I would rather infer it, a book of life lessons that should be referred or that should be adhered by the law students and other people also. So you have very well, very rightly pointed out a entirety, the role of lawyers in national building, and the things that we should adhere to, the ethics, the morality, the harmony that we should keep in ourselves. And you have also pointed out that before changing the world, you should change yourself at first. And a lot of pointers in this particular answer. And this is quite enlightening, I must say, from my personal view. And obviously, our viewers will agree to that. And even I am seeing a few comments coming in for this particular thing. So it was quite enlightening, sir.
I want all now, of you to live in peace and live in happiness and vibrate joy. We should enjoy life. Life is to be enjoyed. Enjoy it. My best wishes to all the children.
Indeed, sir. We should stay away from conflicts and anger and all these things and try to enjoy our life with assimilation and love and peace and everything that you have said in this particular answer. Sir, before parting with this particular interview, I have one small question that I would like to know, and it is quite personal. That is, apart from this legal profession, in which all areas you have special interest?
No, in fact, I have my life is the center core of my life is my spiritual life. Profession is absorbed into my spiritual life. That is why I said, I'm always guided by my spiritual guru, who is the saints, the lineage of Adi Shankara in Shingeri, in Mangalore, near Mangalore. It's a guru parampara of 1200 years old, unbroken lineage. So it is this guru parampara which has been guiding our families for 800 years. And therefore we take guidance from them. So this is exactly what Naniji also says. As an Indian, irrespective of the race, color, caste, or creed, you are tuned to a set of spiritual values of this nation. It is common to everybody. If people say Ramayana and Mahabharata are Hindu texts, they are wrong. You diverse the religious aspect of it, there are so much for to learn. The Honorable Finance Minister wants to talk to me in some case. I'll close it in 5 minutes. So, just 10 minutes. So, now, therefore, this is very important. Therefore, to me, caste, color, creed, race, religion, it's immaterial. Because Indian spirit remains one. And I want all the children to grow under that umbrella and represent in the universe proudly as an Indian and say that this is the tradition we carry and this is what we want to deliver. So apart from my legal profession, children who are interested can log into my Facebook page and my YouTube page. So far I have delivered at least 200 talks. Starting spanning 6 minutes to 1.5 hours on different topics, life, spirituality, philosophy, and various constitutional issues. So I love to talk, and I love to talk to the youth, because it is you who is going to make India whatever it is in the next 30, 40 years. So carry that Indian spirit. That has been my philosophy, and you can see that in my YouTube or Facebook page. Whenever I find time, I talk. Either I talk in the court or I talk here. Please, thanks for this question.
Indeed, sir. Even for this particular session, I have viewed a number of videos, YouTube videos particularly, that you have uploaded in your channel regarding spirituality, value of education, in the child, and a lot number of videos. So that has also inspired me for this particular session in some or other way. Now, as we have come to this, at the end of this particular session, I would like to just take your 30, 40 seconds for a formal vote of thanks. And then we will conclude this particular session.
Yeah, I have to go and join that call, please.
Indeed, sir. That is why I said just only 30, 40 seconds. Thank you, sir. So as we have come to the end of this session, I, on behalf of Team Lex Cognoscenti, would like to extend my profound and greatest, deepest appreciation to the honorable guest of our today's evening, Mr. N. Venkataraman, who is a senior advocate in Supreme Court and currently holding the position of Additional Solicitor General of India. We are really privileged, and you have given a lot of inputs, lot of pointers that we should, as a young legal professional, treasure. So thank you so much, sir, for coming and agreeing to this particular interview session. We are really, really privileged and obliged for your time.
To have lived with and spent time with young children, young India. My best wishes and my best love to all of you. Thanks, Devashish. Thanks, Jyoti, for the valuable time.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Best wishes.
Thank you, sir.